Thank you, Madam Chairman. And I'm so glad that we're having this hearing, and Senator Murkowski and I have talked about it. And a lot of people, you all probably evolved over the years of how you believe or where you get your information. You might have changed your position of climate. Is it climate change real? Was it biblical proportion of time or now the last, I think, the last century? There's no doubt that humans have made a tremendous impact on what we're dealing with. Real, very quickly, can you tell me where you get your basically where you get your facts that you that supports your position? That just if I just know where you all are coming from, because we're trying to get to where we're all on the same sort of facts and where we're getting our information, and you all being the experts you are might have a better insight. So if you could quickly go down, just tell me where your facts come from. Mr. Keller.
Mine come from the U.S. Energy Information Administration, part of DOE. Some of the cost decline projections come from Lazard analysis that looks at the levelized cost of energy. The one I cited was from November of last year. Mm-hmm. And then there's also the analysis on battery storage came from BNEF.
Monsieur.
I get my facts from a variety of the government sources, US EIA, private industry, BP's annual energy outlook, and then what my wife would call an inordinate amount of time on the internet trying to figure out what's real and what's not. And
I mean, here's the only thing, as you all go down here, people basically that differ with you or disagree with you are getting their facts or saying they're getting facts from different sources. Have you looked into those sources saying, that's not real news, that's just not real facts? That might be the distorted facts. So, yes, sir, Joe.
Can I respond to that?
Yeah.
One fact that is frequently misstated, I have to think knowingly, or maybe it's a matter of faith,
okay,
that our electricity supply is losing diversity. The exact opposite is true. And you can prove that mathematically,
okay,
by taking, summing the squares of the different components of our electricity supply in different points, different years. Yeah. And I did that recently, and it's, we are 50% more diverse.
You were able to defuse that, right?
We're 50% more diverse
than we
mathematically,
were,
objectively, using, gotcha, EI data than we were in, yeah, 2005. So that
you,
false
you debunked that one,
crazy.
Okay. Ms. Tierney, or I'm sorry, Dr. Tierney. Okay, Ms. Tierney, Dr. Tierney, where you get your facts?
I spend all my time looking at facts. So on the
which
energy
ones
side,
do you believe?
I follow data collected by the U.S. government through the Energy and Information Administration.
EIA.
It provides tremendous range of facts that are provided by industry.
And you've cross-checked that to make sure that it was accurate. You feel accurate, the accuracy of what you're getting is by cross-checking.
I am quite familiar with it. I was the Assistant Secretary for Policy at the Department of Energy. I'm,
gotcha,
very familiar with,
gotcha,
the EIA and its work. They do great work.
Okay.
I have followed the energy, the IEA, the International,
yeah,
Energy Agency.
There's a little discrepancy between the two in some of the information we receive.
In forecasts, yes.
Okay.
There's, I think there's a lot of historical information that is quite a lot.
Well, IEA was more accurate than our EIA when they forecasted in 2012 or 2015 that the United States would be the leading producer of natural gas. No one thought that would ever happen.
That's true.
How did they hit it right and we missed it?
The EIA, when it forecasts, which is different than facts for historical record,
okay,
which is what I was talking about,
gotcha,
originally, when they forecast based on known policy as it exists today,
gotcha,
in the United States.
Gotcha.
And so there's some differences. But may I just also say,
very quickly,
I get my facts on what's happening with the climate change from the International Panel on Climate Change, on IPCC,
okay,
as well as the National Climate Assessment. I was a co-author of the energy chapter of that. They do great work.
Dr. Medlock.
A variety of sources. I use government sources. I use IEA. I use research networks. I actually participate in conferences with people who are involved in climate research. So,
has your opinions changed since more facts have come out? Have you changed your opinion on climate change?
I don't think I've ever had an opinion on it. It's
okay.
Really,
or your support of it, or your belief.
Informed, it's a data-informed exercise, and you know, scientifically, we've known, you know, that CO2 is a forcing agent for a century. This is not new information.
Okay.
It's always been about you know, what's the degree to which it's actually impacting things. And that's where research is opening doors, opening
Great. Doors. Dr. Jacobson, Ms. Jacobson.
Thank you. Business Council and its members get a lot of the same information from the same data sets, and we decided about 7 years ago to put it together in a free basis for the public and for policymakers. Mm-hmm. It also, I think it's important to check in with industry. The historical data is very strong. We're really blessed by the investments that our government has made. And, you know, just a plug for one other opportunity, you know, this jobs data that we're seeing is very significant. And the U.S. government has supported that type of endeavor before to track U.S. jobs across the board. I hope that the U.S. government will continue to look for areas to capture that data. It's now being done by outside sources. But again, this fact book, and we brought copies for everybody, their committee and their staff, is again available for free online, and it uses government sources, industry, other independent analysts. Off of the Business Council's website, it's done independently by Bloomberg New Energy Finance. We commission it each year, but it's bcse.org.
bcse.org.
But again, we have copies for anybody who'd like.
Thank you all so much.
Thank you.
We have more questions coming.
Thank you, Senator Manchin.
The National Climate Assessment says within the next 10 years, if we don't make drastic changes as a globe, as the world, as 7 billion of us living on planet Earth, if we don't do something within 10 years, it could be irreversible of the damage that's done to the climate. Are you all in agreement with that statement, the 10 years? And next of all, if that's the case, you have China over 60% relying on fossil coal. You have India almost 70% reliant. They ain't changing anytime quick. What do we do? Let's jump right in.
I'm happy to jump on that one. I will preface my remarks with the following statement. At the Baker Institute, we have the opportunity to host over the last 6 years, on average, 23 different international and ministerial level delegations for conversations about energy and environment. And the one thing that is just remarkably true about every one of those conversations is that they're all different. And that's eye-opening, because we all view the world from where we sit. And the reality on the ground in China is very different than the reality on the ground in India, is very different than the reality on the ground in London, than in New York, than in Washington, D.C. And the challenges that those governments, local and national, are faced with are in many ways very different. What one group considers an existential crisis may not be considered existential.
I mean, it's a 10-year cycle. Is that a fair statement?
So, that's what I'm getting to. The point about 10 years, I don't believe that the world's going to end in 10 years, no. But I think it's important that sitting in the United States in the developed part of the world, we actually lead by example, which is why I've highlighted the role of R&D, because you look at countries like China, for example, there's 254 gigawatts of coal-fired generation capacity under construction right now. That is larger than the entire U.S. coal fleet at the moment. So when we think about that, when we think about CO2 as being a problem of the global commons, it really means that we need to lead by example.
Well, doctor, if we're leading by example, we've done scrubbers, low-NOx boilers, and baghouses.
Absolutely.
They're not implementing any of those.
I agree with you 100%.
Well, then how do we lead by examples?
The scrubber issue, though, is not a CO2 issue. That's a local air pollution issue. So I agree with you 100%, and that's where it actually comes down to cost.
So the baghouses.
So you've got to address things, and this is where innovation has actually been vital. You know, what's the parasitic load of these technologies as we attach them to existing power plants? And that's one of the reasons why they're not actually operated in some places in China, because that load's
too high. It's all cost.
So
I know that.
It's about economics.
Same thing as carbon capture sequestration, because it's not basically economically feasible to lose
the
power.
It's not economically feasible now, but neither was shale in 1985.
Correct.
Right, and that's my point.
But I'm just saying, you said we lead by example. For the last 20 years, we removed particulates from the air in America.
Yes, we have.
We've closed the old coal-fired plants. And they still haven't followed our example, because either we have to use our trading policies and our basically the tariffs that we charge to get into our market to give them an incentive to do what they don't want to do because of cost factors.
Could I add to this just one sec? I spent a lot of time on China's energy outlook. China is actually an unsung story on a lot of innovations. And I think the main point of what I'm about to say is that the U.S. needs to continue to advance technology leadership so that we don't get our
I think Dr. Brill said basically if we don't do something basically with research
they will.
And development, we sat on our hands for the last decade and didn't do enough.
Well, I will say this. If you look at federal in real dollars, I have a colleague that's actually written about this. He was a former science advisor to the Clinton administration. In real dollars, federal R&D spending has been declining for the last 30 years, and that doesn't make any sense.
And they are building advanced reactors. They have huge wind construction. Sure. They are dealing with the air pollution, tragic air pollution issues associated with their choices. They are doing a lot, and we need to step it up so that we don't lose to them on these competitive technologies. So that's a reason for me.
They're not using them, though.
They're
not using them. They're turning off their scrubbers. They're turning. It's not CO2 killing people in China.
Oh, I know that.
It's basically particulates.
Of course.
And they're not. So you can, you know, in that type of a country.
Look, these are bigger issues than just China. I was just in Seoul, and I had a really interesting meeting at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs with the director of their climate and energy program. And he said on the worst days, 80% of the PM in the atmosphere in Seoul is from Beijing. That's remarkable. So transboundary issues are incredibly important, and that's where governments around the world have to come together.
The final question I want to ask very quickly, because my time's running out, is that basically regulated versus deregulated states on the PSC, public service commissions and all that, you know, we have a regulated state. So basically the energy that we need, we produce, we regulate that. We don't have the market in a rural area. Deregulation has not worked in rural America, I can assure you. We've gotten screwed every time. I don't know how you all look, and Joe, I know you were on that. How do you look about regulated versus deregulated, how it's working in the marketplaces? I think you just all said has not driven down prices. It's not brought more competition in.
Retail competition has largely been limited to states that had very high retail rates to begin with. Mm-hmm. They also were states that typically had large industrial customers, and those industrial customers felt like cost properly attributed to residential customers, real people, were being assigned to them. They wanted to flee those costs. So industrials typically have been the driving force behind retail competition. Not surprisingly, they've also been the primary beneficiary. And that in many of these states, residential rates are higher from a competitive supplier, the offerings from a competitive suppliers, than they are from the regulated utilities. There have also been marketing and fraud investigations of some competitive suppliers in a number of states. New York, Connecticut, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, I think. So there are some questions about the competitive suppliers.
I just add one thing to that real quick. We recently did a study looking at the Texas situation, and I think it's dangerous to paint with a broad brush because the introduction of liberalized markets looks different in every single application. Texas is a case actually where retail rates have declined relative to regulated rates, and you actually see side by side regulated utilities and competitive enterprise, and you've seen successes there. So.
I have a group of fellow West Virginians in the ante room right here. We're working on and talking about energy and the effects of energy. Let me just say that the hearing that we had today, and I want to thank Chairperson Murkowski because we talked about this. There's no one would have expected her and I coming from the largest producing states of fossil, coal and natural gas in my state, amount of oil that we rely on from Texas, from Alaska. Mm-hmm. I know, Texas, that was a mistake.
What? You're talking about that small state.
The little state down south. Anyway, so for us to be able to say, listen, we're all in this together. The thing I always felt was wrong in the tax policies and all these incentives, and Dr. Mell, like you mentioned, yeah, they could just wipe the state clean. Let's find out who survives. I understand trying to help a developing or a maturing industry. I understand that. Someone told, I heard my father one time, and people, my grandfather especially, he used to give credit and help people, and he had a little grocery store. And he told a guy one time, the guy said, Papa, can you carry me for a while? And he said, honey, your mother only carried you for 9 months. So he was trying to say, when's enough, okay? We can't wean ourselves off in America. We just don't, whether it's on food stocks or whatever it is. The thing about it is we're shifting a little bit right now. We're not weaning away from fossil. We're shifting the fossil utilization more to gas now than we have been. And I think, Joe, you mentioned that and showed we almost doubled. With that, the concern I have, because we have an ocean of gas under us in West Virginia, an ocean of gas
and it's coming on strong all the time. We haven't even tapped into Rogersville yet. We're still in Marcellus and Utica, and it's going to come on even stronger. But I'm concerned that they're taking this for granted because there's so much supply of that left that they're not looking at how do we protect our drilling, how do we basically capture our methane, how do we transport safely, how do we make sure that it's not interruptible by sabotage, because it is not a baseload fuel if you look at the interruption that can be caused from the pipelines to the storage to basically our pump stations, which can freeze up in adverse inclement weather. All of these things have to be considered. The other thing I want to tell all of my friends who believe that we can switch immediately, I said, if you're saying that renewables are 18%, then tell me what 5 hours of the day you want your electricity or your energy. So as long as we come to the facts that we have to have an all-in energy policy and transition ourselves into a much better place. The other thing I wanted to say was policy under, there was a previous president, he and I had very lively conversations. I said, if you're going to change your energy policy, that might not be as realistic of what we're dealing with and demands we have on the energy sector. Can't you at least use your credits in states that have lost a tremendous amount of energy jobs, traditional energy jobs, whether it's going to be oil production, whether it's going to be in coal production, whatever. And because the tax credit should basically leave nobody behind. If we're transitioning to a new fuel or a new energy provider, then you shouldn't leave the people behind, because I guarantee you, and I've said this, a coal miner will build you the best darn windmill you've ever seen. They'll build you the best solar panels. They've survived underground for hundreds of years. They know what to do, and they're all experts as far as in their fields. And this is what we haven't done well in these policies. So anything I would say, we're going to rely on you a good bit in this committee, I would assume. This is just the beginning. It's not the ending, one and done. This is something we have to face. What we have to do is make sure those people who believe that we can switch immediately, I've not heard one testimony from a professional that this 10-year cycle can happen. You can be decarbonized in 10 years. Well, you can carbonize, reduce your carbon footprint by the technology through research and development, which we haven't done for the last 10 years. So the only thing I would say is I hope that we're keeping our eye on the ball, that as we move to different sources of energy, that we're doing it in the cleanest fashion and using the technology that the rest of the world should be following, because right now they're not. And unless we use the whole carrot and stick mentality, what's in it for them if they do this, even though they don't have an incentive to do it other than we want to be in our market. They want to be basically open to our markets in a much more advantageous way. I think there'll be more, especially India right now, I worry about them because I know how hard they're coming on strong with more power plants, I think, coal-fired plants any place in the world. If that's, I think they could be accurate. And they're doing it with less pollution controls than any place else in the world. And we have the technology to prevent that from happening. I just want to say, Madam Chairman, thank you again. This is so well timed, and I think it would lead the Energy and Natural Resource Committee leading the way and showing that we can, coming from Alaska and West Virginia, we're very much inclined to the changes we have to be made, but also in a realistic way and pragmatic way. Thank you.